Good morning. Have any of you wondered, while walking into a supermarket, why are the things displayed in a specific order or arranged in a specific way when we just walk across the aisles? This is not done just for the sake of fun, but definitely there is some science and logic behind it. When we anytime walk into a hypermarket or a supermarket or even a departmental store, there is something done to attract every shopper's attention. Today's session will give you a sneak peek into what is neuromarketing and how brands undertake sensory branding to popularize their brands. All of us are captivated by our senses: sight, hearing, smell, taste, and touch. These senses tell us, make the major part of our decisions. When we see some object we would like to buy or we would like to avoid. So when we are trying to buy it, what is that which makes us attracted towards those senses, those objects or those services, or what makes us reject them? So these sensory branding is a very big tool used by the marketers today to attract customers to their products and services. Welcome everybody to our webinar on Introduction to Neuromarketing. Professor Arul Jyoti, my colleague, and myself, Lakshmi Kannan from Ramaiah Institute of Management, will be giving you an introduction into neuromarketing. Have any of you wondered what could be this neuromarketing? This is not just a simple logic. It is backed up by facts, empirical data. It is a market research tool. When we say market research tool, we will see what are the different tools used, how are they used, and as a consumer, where do you think it is impacting you? So this session will cover four major aspects. First is introduction into neuromarketing. Is what is neuromarketing, its tools, and how is it going to be used? The second part will contain sensory branding as an important tool in neuromarketing. And finally, we wrap it up with fun exercises. Doesn't it sound interesting? Yes, here we go. Neuromarketing is nothing but a market research tool which is used to attract customers in a scientific way towards a product or service. As you can see in my screen, the first aspect is the brain. Okay, definitely, yes, we start everything with the brain. And we associate some amount of science with it. Brain is, we can control our emotions. We don't have to show our emotions everywhere. But definitely we cannot control our feelings because it's involuntary. Feelings are more emotional and feelings are more mental and emotions are more physical, which can be seen outside. Based on this, the marketers, the producers of products and services, create advertisements. So they kindle your emotions. The moment your emotions are kindled, you associate yourself or even disassociate yourself with products or services. This creates a major instinct in your brain saying that, yes, I like it. Oh, no, I don't like it. So this instinct, the recording of these instincts and kindling of the brain is what is done scientifically with the help of fMRI, electroencephalogram, and myography. And there are a lot of scientific tools which are being used here. Then customer also gets insights from other sources about the same product or the service. All these put together, along with your emotions, which is playing a major part, will help you take decisions on whether to say yes to the product or no to the product, or maybe now or maybe later. All these decisions are taken with the base of these consumer insights we get and the instincts in our head. And when we have a choice, very close choice of A and B, we say yes to a A and no to a B based only on these instincts, what we have in our mind. And finally, when all this is done, the purchase takes place. This purchase is the last, level or, last leg of the entire cycle of marketing and sales. This is what all the big marketing companies, all the big service companies are looking at to attract the customers and make them, buy the product or the service. So this is a basic introduction to what is neuromarketing. It is called the new science of consumer decisions. Consumers don't make decisions at random. or at least it's proven they don't make it random. And this is a very big empirical study which has been proven that with the help of scientific and technical gadgets and results, we are trying to say that, yes, if the product is like this, the customer will react like that. Maybe, maybe not, we will express our feelings, but definitely, yes, there is a feeling in our mind which runs through. And what is neuromarketing? It's a basic market research method that leverages powerful techniques to provide insights into customers' decisions and action, which ultimately guides better marketing decisions. We are trying to take decisions based on the powerful techniques. Why am I saying it's very powerful? Because it is scientifically proven and your brain actions and reactions are recorded in a gadget. And not every company may be able to afford this. This is a very, very expensive technique. Large MNCs will try to adopt this, and as it involves a lot of cost and time also. Successful brands are the ones that deliver feelings and emotions. Finally, the decision making of any purchase depends on feelings and emotions of a person. You, me, everybody who buys anything, it's 99% feeling and emotions. Very, very rarely there is a necessity. When we buy medicines, we don't have any feelings and emotion towards it, but we rather go buy it because we have to buy it. But when we have a choice between medicine A or B, maybe we take these into consideration before buying those medicines. The study of how people's brains react to advertising. We all think, okay, we're just seeing the advertisement, we don't like it, it's just one time pass kind of a thing. Subconsciously, everything gets recorded into your brain and your brain starts reacting. That reaction is what comes into effect when you start purchasing the product or when you make a decision to purchase a product. This form of human touch marketing gives marketers the power to design campaigns that sets them apart from their competitors and resonates with their target audience. There are some jingles, there are some ads which you've seen, which keep resonating in your mind. The reason is not that you love the product or you love the manufacturer, you love something about it. It's just that it's got subconsciously registered in your mind so that you would, next time when you see the product in the supermarket, definitely you will go pick it up rather than the ones which you have not been exposed to. This technique is also a reward and punishment. When I say reward, if the ads are good, if the explanation is good, or maybe the colors are beautiful, the sound is good, people get awarded and the company gets rewarded. And if the opposite works well as well. So when you say it is not good, it becomes a punishment for the company, saying you did the marketing badly, so you pay a price for it. You might not get the kind of audience what you expected. It creates a pleasurable experience for consumers to keep them attached and coming back to the product. To keep them attached is one great thing, and if the consumer comes back, it's a second thing because you don't have to spend additional money on marketing. There are brands like Coca-Cola which keep coming back to the company because they're attached to the brand and rather not change the brand themselves. So this has built a very high brand value in today's world. We'll see what is a practical view of neuromarketing through a video.
What is neuromarketing? In simple words, neuromarketing is the application of neuroscience to marketing. Neuromarketing includes the direct use of brain imaging, scanning, or other brain activity measurement technology to measure a subject's response to specific products, packaging, advertising, or other marketing elements. Researchers use either the functional magnetic resonance imaging, or EEG, the acronym for electroencephalography, to measure changes in activity in parts of the brain and to learn why consumers make the decisions they do, and what part of the brain is telling them to do it. A.K. Pradeep, in his best-selling works, The Buying Brain, Secrets for Selling to the Subconscious Mind, narrates different implications to neuromarketing. We know, for example, that the soft scent of lemon increases sales in seafood restaurants. The subtle smell of grass near the dairy aisle could take consumers back to a simpler, more carefree time, and subconsciously remind them of the fields the products come from. In high-end car or luggage stores, the rich, deep scent of polished leather calls to mind luxury, relaxation, and reward. In clothing stores, the invigorating scent of sea or romantic mix of roses and violets suffices the experience and makes purchasing a product associated with those memories powerful. Realtors know that baking cookies seduces buyers into considering a property a home. We are surrounded by neuromarketing. Whenever we look at something, whether it be a poster, logo, or a package, it activates a range of associated ideas in our mind. Neuroscientists call this effect priming. Some of these ideas, which neurotechniques can measure, relate to the feelings and concepts that an ad or brand logo may trigger in us. Some of them activate goals in us, often without our conscious awareness. For example, your desire to treat yourself to something expensive may be triggered earlier in the day by seeing a poster for a luxury brand. What kind of neuromarketing have you been exposed to lately? Please feel free to share suggestions or additional tools by writing to us or leave your comments. If you enjoy this video, give it a...
Okay, I think all of you must have got a quick sneak peek into what is neuromarketing.
My video.
And this gives a basic introduction of how the entire stuff works. You see, what are the methods how the neuromarketing is used? First, tracking eye movements to see which parts of a web page grab the user's attention. Normally, when we see a web page, we don't go read the whole web page like this. Instead, we go to parts which attract us too much. And that is the reason certain parts get, you know, more of data or more of information, which is very important as compared to the others. Then we're using a technique called electroencephalography, imaging of the brain, to determine one's emotional response to an ad or a product. Yes, consciously this gadget is fixed in, or this apparatus is fixed into a person. When they go see a lot of products, or when they're shown visuals of the product, how the brain reacts. That is usage of encephalography to record or track the movement of the brain to see the response to the product or the service. Determining which version of an ad generates the most brain activity as seen in fMRI. This is a magnetic resonance imaging scan, which again tells you there are two types of imaging. Once we do it with the metabolic activity, the other one we do it with the electrical activity, the current flow inside the brain. So that will definitely tell. Maybe outside we say, okay, we don't like the product. It doesn't look all that appealing. I don't want this. I really don't care for this. But inside your brain, it slowly, you know, reacts. And that reaction is getting recorded. That recording is being used by a lot of companies today to see if the customer is really attracted towards your product, or is, you know, trying to say that he's attracted, but actually he is not. So these are some of the techniques which are used in neuromarketing widely across the world, though we have a lot of other techniques also. Now we will see what are the tools that are used in neuromarketing. We will not go into all these tools in detail. I'll just give you a bird's eye view. The tools are basically divided into three: record the metabolic activity of the brain, record the electric activities in the brain without recording the brain activities at all. Maybe the last one many companies can start doing, whether they're small, medium, or large, but the first two definitely is done by larger corporations. Positron emission tomography is today majorly used in the world for detecting cancer and the spread of cancer, but definitely the brain reaction also can be recorded. Based on that reaction, the marketing can be done. Next, we talk about functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI. This again says, how does your brain react? Maybe there's some positional change in the brain. There is some reaction of the structure of the brain which says that, okay, I like this product. Oh no, I don't like this product. Maybe there is some reaction like that. And that is getting recorded. So that record again is used by the companies to attract the, persuade the customers, or maybe if the customers are not happy, just change the way they advertise. Then we go into the second part called recording the electric activity in the brain. Just like you have ECG, electrocardiography, this is electroencephalography, which is done to the brain. Steady state tomography again is a study where they put on some recorders, sensors, and they see if the movement of the brain. Then TMS, transcranial, across the brain magnetic stimulation. Then we have magnetoencephalography. Again, this is with the wave, magnetic waves around the brain. We'll see how things, your brain reacts, and that gets plotted on a screen, or maybe a printout can be taken later. With that recording, we'll see how it reacts and whether it's a positive reaction or a negative reaction. Finally, the biggest and the most advantageous test of all, electroencephalography, which marks the record, electric recording of your brain, electric activity. So when your brain overreacts, you know, there are movements, graphs which move up and down. The brain doesn't react. There's another set of movements of the brain. And finally, when the brain underreacts, they think, oh, no, I don't like it. There's another set of graphs which is again recording. And there's a third, but the most upcoming set of activities, tools which we can use to track the brain activity. Facial coding, the reactions which you give on your face, and that is being coded, that's being recorded. And with that, people, the psychologists and the psychiatrists together, they come to conclusions with the code. Then implicit association test. Implicit association test is nothing but it is already agreed, or there is a reaction which is already known. That is another kind of test which the companies do to find out whether you're interested, you're attracted towards the product. Skin conductance. All these are, it looks very superficial, but there's a very huge scientific backing for this, and which is proven to be correct in most of the data which has been collected over the years. Eye tracking, that many of us know how it is done. And the more attracted you are towards a product or a part of a website or something, you keep looking at it and that gets registered as a photograph in your subconscious mind. Facial electromyography, again, they put sensors on your face. The way your face reacts and the way how it emotes feelings, that is recorded again. And that shows some results. Based on the results, the marketers can take the decision. Measuring psychological responses, that is commonly used everywhere, even by the small stores, the stores next door, and by big corporations. How psychologically, you frown, you're not all right, you smile, you're very happy, you raise your eyebrows, you're super excited. So all these are kind of, different responses, physiological responses, which are measured by the marketers to attract, to find out the level of attraction of customers. Has it been too technical and scientific? We'll move to something lighter. See, the companies that use neuromarketing today, they are big companies. Google, Amazon, Coca-Cola, Microsoft, PayPal, eBay. Out of these, you cannot say only companies that produce products use it, because Hyundai, Pepsi, Coca-Cola are all product companies. Whereas Google, Microsoft, PayPal, eBay and all are service-based, right? Companies producing both products and services make good use of neuromarketing today to attract customers or make them move towards your product or your services to increase their sales. Of course, the final end of all this is increasing the market share or the sales in the market. These are some popular brands and colors. When you see red, when you see orange, when you see yellow, when you see green, when you see blue, when you see purple, you see all these colors and you associate some brands. Can all of you recollect some quick brands which are associated with the colors, or think of some popular brands which you like, and you see which color are they associated with? Do you like them for their color, or you like them for the brand and then associate the color? There are a lot of questions which run through your mind. From now on, my colleague, Professor Arul Jyoti, will take you on to sensory branding to prove how senses are attracting customers to the product or the service and take you forward from here. I'll see you back for the fun exercises.
Thank you, Professor Lakshmi. This is Arul Jyoti here. Good morning, one and all, and welcome all the participants. Before I take up the session, I would like to trigger you all by some of instinct situation that takes place in our daily life. We all will go to a shopping or any outlet, and we'll see a lot of product are placed in the outlet. Very colorful, very visually appealing. And somehow, consciously, subconsciously, you get attracted to the product. And ultimately, sometimes result in buying the product with have no idea of buying the product. Go to an ice cream parlor. You see 20 different flavors has been put for the display. You really don't know which to pick and what to pick. Maybe for the first time you want to try some different flavor. So what you want to do is, you'll ask the shopkeeper to give a sample of a taste. So based on that, you buy a product. You buy ice cream. Maybe the third instinct, go to a jewelry shop. The kind of ambience, the lights, aroma, that the product itself start glittering. Again, you'll be so connected, attached to the product where you want to touch, see and feel the product and try out the product. Why such things takes place in our life when we go for a shopping? Is it conscious or something we call it as a subconscious? This is what today's session I'm going to take you through all. Welcome all. And I'm going to take through your session, Insight into a Sensory Branding. Look at the image. It all talks about the five senses. Every individual is comprehend everything around us through our sense. So they are directly linked to the limbic part of the brain that is responsible for these different reactions. If you see limbic part, Professor Lakshmi would have showed you in the video where the limbic part is connected in the human brain. This is very much responsible for our sense, to receive our sense, and the outcome can be a pleasure, a feeling, memories, and sometimes it has a very, very emotional touch among the individuals. So what is sensory branding? What is sensory branding? It's a type of a marketing that appeals to all sense in relation to the brand. It's a sense that relates with the customer on a high emotional level. Now, emotional associations in the customer mind by appealing to their sense. So what marketers does is they use the sense to trigger the subconscious nature of an individual so that very efficient way of engaging the consumers or the customers. Where it all starts, stimuli, exposure. The very first thing, your stimulus, which is being taken by a different sense, that is where exactly the sensory branding takes up. Through an exposure, how the exposures are received? The exposures are received through these sense, a sight, see, sound, hear, odor, smell, flavor, taste, and texture is a touch. Through this five sense, we try and receive or we get exposure to the stimuli. What is the outcome of this? Maybe a marketer's want to influence a customer choice. They want to create emotional connect with the brand. They want to distinct themselves from the other competitors or maybe from the other brand too. Changing customer preferences and very personality focused campaigning. So maybe these are the reasons where sensory branding is much, much happening in the market. Maybe most of us subconsciously, we may not feel all this, but it is truly happening. It's a very high scientific research that's happening behind for this sensory branding. So let me take you through the session with that includes influence of the sense on the branding. If you see the first sense, it is seeing, vision. I would like to start vision. Content is not king if no one is looking. Definitely yes. So that is where your sight, your vision plays a very, very important and the vital role. It's the most stimulated of five senses of sensory marketing. Color and shapes are the most important in the visual factor. Through sight, well recognizing the logos, colors, schemes, just in a matter of a second, and different point of view or the perspective can take place, something that make them notice. But please remember, vision can also take place lot of biases. You show something in an advertisement, but when a customer or an individual walks into an outlet and try out the product, it may not really match. That's where the biases takes place. And after judgment of the product size, the consumption also takes place through vision. That's why vision is very, very important. If you see the look at the image here, Reliance Smart, I picked a Reliance Smart image. intentionally the layout and the design of the building is planned, which is more and more transparent from the outside view, the external view. Even a person bypassing the retail outlet or this Reliance Mart is able to view the kind of product that is available or it is being displayed. So that itself instigates and triggers an individual to walk into a retail mart and find out what else is there. So you are giving some sort of a multi-sensory experience to an individual and definitely a different sort of an experience. This is where marketers increase the footfall of an individual. Go to the second image. If you see the second image, the kind of product, the assortment that is placed on the shelf, it is very, very colorful. If a person turns and take up a 90 degree view or the side, or go through a 180 degree view or the side, your products looks amazing, very, very feasible and very, very attractive in the eyes. And the arrangements, color combination itself instigates an individual's go to the product, touch the product, see the product and try it with the product. So this is what something, a power of a vision is all talking about. This is another interesting image. This is again inside visual merchandising. Most of the retail outlets, they actually plan it in such a way that the ambience, the kind of vision has to be very, very appealing to any of the individual. The first image talks about the theme-based visual merchandising, displaying of the product, where just a look where an individual is really propagated to go try the product and test the product. If you look at the second image, it is a very, very continuous. Look at the first image talks about the displaying of the product. And if you see the second image, by the way you take up the next floor or the next stage, look at the kind of site or the kind of display that they put up. Everywhere the product has been displayed. I mean to say the consumers are more and more engaged by the way the product are being displayed, through which it helps them to seek for the better product and their experience could be further better. So we are not only talking about the arrangement of the product or the colors or the kind of ambience that they create. It also talks about something of creativity in advertisement. The way you put up the advertisement itself, where the individual will be able to connect to a brand. If you look at the first image, it is actually one of the paint companies, a Coop Paints. Look at their advertisement. The advertisement is put up in one of the shop parking lot. If you see the view from afar, you can see the paint is just flowing through the building and it is spread across the parking lot. I mean, nobody just can't forget this brand. If this is the sort of an advertisement, which is really a benchmarking for the branding true sense. Take up the next image, Kinder Joy. The shape itself stands out in a crowd. And moreover, they have differentiated the color based on the gender. If you see, the Kinder Joy blue is more for the boys and the Kinder Joy pink, it's more for the girls. So the shape of the product is also one of the visual appealing, and it is also one of the important factor when you're talking about the seeing sense. And second is a Parachute body lotion. If you see the shape of the bottle, it is exactly a feminine. It is exclusively designed for these feminine gender. And if you see the color combinations, which is having a different flavors, yes, again, this stands out in a crowd. And the third is a Doisho soap. So this soap is again giving a very, very meaningful of shape of the product. Yeah. Next, sound. Another important sense is one of the most evocative sound. Now, sound can be a symbolic for a brand. A sound connects us, very strong connective connections between a memory and the sound. It transports us through a memories and inspires the action. Reach on a brand on a new level, because sound is one sort of a branding where without touching the image or without touching the product, just with the hearing, you are able to recall your brand. And today, marketers are more into an audio brand. Now, what is this audio brand? That is, again, the objective of this audio brand is for their visual identity. By playing this audio brand, they'll be able to exactly recollect the nausea and the notes of the jingles and the sound bites. Now, when I talk about the sound, It also talks about the languages, bringing the languages in the sound. Why? Why languages? If you see the advertisement, it is in the vernacular language, multilinguistic. Why is this? That is again to create a level of belongingness to the community. Now, sound itself will have a huge impact on moods and the involvement in the shopping. Look at the images here. The atmospheric and the second image is the customer walking in the outlet. The first image is maybe you're talking about an coffee restaurant, coffee outlet or any restaurant. When the music is played around the atmospheric, look at the quality of the sensations that brings in the customer involvement of consuming the product. Sound will definitely relax your mind, stress, monotonous, and it energizes your energy level. And you try and be very much involved in the shopping and consuming the product in a more refreshing manner. Go to a retail outlet. While you do a shopping, when you shop the product, based on the tempo of the music, the customer take a step. If it's a very, very pop-up music, the step could be more faster and their mind triggers in such a way that, yeah, involvement of choosing the product would be bit more higher level. Yeah, so this is a small exercise for you all. I'm going to play a few sound teasers. In the chat box, kindly guess and type your answers. Hear your first tone. Yeah, I could guess some of the answers here. That's right. So all of you got it. It's an IPL. Great. Here comes your second teaser. Nice. Go to the third teaser, Nirma. Okay. The last.
Freshness. Fresh is back.
That's nice. Hope you all enjoyed it. And you all have recalled the brand. So this is one of the effect of a sound. So hearing plays a very good role by reinforcing the brand image, the brand identity. So this is how marketers are able to tap their market through using the sense of sound. I'll take you through the next sense, smelling. Odor. Now, in odor, it is actually tied up to our limbic system, olfactory bulb or hippocampus. What happens here is it recognizes its role in emotion and it determines the memory. And some of the fact of this odor or the fragrance is Humans will have an ability to recognize more than 10,000 different scents, and they can also recognize this over a period of a time. So fragrance is one of the most crucial scents for all marketing and for branding purpose. If you see the sense of smell, it actually affects what we remember about the brand experience. Now companies are really experimenting with their own signature scent and well-based experience. If you're going through this hotel, Shangri-La and many other hotels, every individuals or the consumers who have used the service, along with the feel of the fragrance, they are able to relate and connect to the other factors in the hotels. So this is how the recall takes place and the brand identity takes place through the sense of the odor. If you see, you have ambient sense. Now, ambient sense is something that is present in the ambience. Now, the scent that's present in the ambience will definitely increase the recall and the recognition of the brand. Look at the first image. That's the image of a coffee. We all go to a Starbucks and definitely we love and like to consume coffee because of the smell, because of the flavor of the coffee. The smell, the odor is amazing and excellent. Yeah, I just came across in one of the articles that in one of the country, Starbucks, along with the coffee, they were coming up with some egg-based menu. After some time, what happens, this egg smell was actually distracting the fragrance of the coffee. They thought that they may lose the importance on this. That's the reason they just stopped that egg-based menu that is prepared in the Starbucks and they shifted to this coffee because coffee is going to be one of their USP as in the flavor of the odor or the fragrance. If you see the next image is all talking about your perfume industry. The entire perfume industry brand themselves through this fragrances. The pleasant scent. Pleasant scent is more of associated with the characteristics of the odor, like jasmine or lavender or the rose. So this is how this enhances the evaluation of the product. Today, if you take any product for this matter, it comes up with the different flavors and the different fragrances. So when you do this, what happens is customer has got a lot of a choice. They don't shift your brand. They stay with your brand, but they have a lot of choice to pick up it. And you can't just restrict with your perfume and with your food product. It is also extended to your, these sort of a product, your fabric products. Can anybody think of your floor cleaning has a perfume-based product? Your clothes, you have a perfumes there. So the kind of fabrics or the fragrance that is involved, that has also been included in the floor cleaning as well as in the dry cleans. Next image is Fab India. So your fragrance is not only restricted to the food or the food products or with your fabrics related product. It has also been there with your apparels. Now, if you go to a Fab India, the very entrance, they have a scent with a lemongrass. That itself shoots your mood. And if you go further, look for the display of the product or display of the apparels, display of their outfits, and everywhere you can just feel the fragrance of the khadi. Now, this is what the very, very, a kind of branding it happens through the fragrance. So, fragrance is one way where you can engage your consumers is what most research says that. So, people try and spend most of the time in the outlet. If they find a good ambience and the fragrance is cool, which ease their stress as well as enjoy the shopping experience. Let me take you to the next sense of the taste. Now, highly combination of all the five senses is the taste because it's a unique taste which helps you to establish your foothold in the minds of the consumer. You can target audience definitely with free samples, issuing of free samples and tasters of the food to be served. I think this we are experiencing. Just now I started my session of tasting a product, then trying to buy the product. Then brand and shopper offers a very free sample product that creates the impact on the consumer minds. So your taste is not only restricted to this. Today it is going to another level. Like for example, looking out for a product information. So first of all, they look at, if you are a vegetarian, first thing they look at whether it is, The product has a mix of non-veg or the vegetarian. So they go through the ingredients. And the next thing is the diet control. They also see the kind of nutrition facts and values based on which they like to go and buy the product. So taste where it has some sort of a multi-sensation. Now, what is this multi-sensation? I'll take you through this example of a Lay's. Now, multi-sensation is the habituation and the satiation. Now, what happens in the habitations? In a habitation, what happens as you keep consuming, so at one point of time, what happens is you may get bored of, you may nullify with that flavor. So you want something to try, a different, an alternative. That is where a consumer think of looking for an alternative for your Lay's. So here Lay's, the alternative can be your Pringles. If I say Lay's, yeah, no doubt, the taste is excellent, amazing. You would have tried all sort of a flavor. Now, the Pringles is brought into the product in the market, and if you say it's not a fried one, and it is a baked one, again, all diet-conscious people will be willing to shift to the Pringles because it's a baked one, and the taste is amazing. It is morely customized to our Indian taste. So this is what the habituation satiation takes place in the taste concept. So all branding people, all the marketers and the manufacturers are very keen enough to ensure that the customer do not move out to another brand, to their competitor brand because of the taste. That's the reason they come up with lot of flavoring options in the market. Kellogg's. I would like to quote this example for the Kellogg's. Now Kellogg's had run through a trialing campaigning in lot of schools. They distributed, they issued the chocos to all school kids, and they asked to try this product at home and give a review. So what happened after that, after consuming of the product, I can tell you more than 6 months, all kids, whenever they feel hungry or morning, they are not able to gulp the breakfast. For them, immediate the product that tickles in their mind is chocos. So this is how the taste is driving through the campaigning and trying to retain their brand concept in the minds of the consumer. The same campaigning happened with Maggi. Maggi, when we were very young, we all got the sample pack. And from that time, any hunger concept, tasty you want to fulfill our hunger, it's just a 2 minutes because the brand itself is able to position themselves as a 2 minutes Maggi. We immediately cook and eat. Same thing with your Haldiram's. Good Indian snacks variety. So all this is something which is where individuals is able to recall their brand, which remains in their mind for a longer period of time. Finally, let's go to touch. Now, warm sensation promotes confidence. The touch is the sensory receptor are manipulated maybe through your weight, your material, the texture, the softness and the comfort of the product. Many people do not shop online. This can be one of the reasons because they can't touch and feel the product. Your area skin occupies highest sensor when compared to all other senses. Touch helps customer make more conscious decision. One of the most impacted conscious decision is the touch. So individual, what they do is they react to the product differently when they cannot touch the product. You show something in an advertisement when they walk into a shop, if they see something, be careful, they form their opinion. They form certain perceptions about the product. And as you all know, first impression is the best impression. What you promise, you have to deliver. And that they are going to try out with the touch sense. So if the things matches up, if your brand identity and brand equity matches up, and that's where the perception is formed, that's where the consumer are able to make the judgment on the brand. So touch is a very, very sensitive thing, and you have to brand it very carefully. Touch, in a technical language, we call this as a haptic. It's the only sense which such a strong ramification for the consumer behavior. Because as I said, because they're touching the product, they make their own opinions. They make their own perceptions. They judge the product and their learnings are totally different when they actually touch the product. Here are the examples. Go to your mobile phones, the showroom. Intentionally, all the products are displayed because they want the customers to touch the product. Look at what are the features of the product, try the product. Only then, you know, they are also convinced, only if they're convinced, their next action could be to buy the product. Similarly, when you see this MacBook, oh my God, the soft keys, the keys are very, very soft. The texture is very, very soft. And if you see that, the touch concept of this MacBook is amazing. People like to touch these soft keys. And one of the product branding is the Dove soap. Now, Dove Touch, it's because it's 1/4 of a moisture in the soap. The touch itself is a very, very softening. So this is all the sense where a customer will be able to recall the brand and totally get emotion, get connected with the brand. Finally, I have a two multi-sensory branding examples for you all. This is an IKEA. If you see IKEA, you can just look at the external image of the IKEA. I don't know, many of you would have wondered why from outside some of the hypermarket or single branded outlet, they will cover the entire buildings through some of the advertisement or the big banners. If you get inside the outlet, people will not be able to view outside what is happening. Again, it is one of the intention way of building planning and architectures of the building. They don't want the customers to get distracted by peeping outside. People will peek outside because they want to know what is the time. Is it getting late? If this distraction takes place, what happens in a very hurry-burry situation, they just buy the product, they just grab the product without even having a sense towards the product. This is one of the reasons why today if you see the spa, if you see the mall, if you see the big bazaar, and if you see such outlets, they just cover the entire external part with a lot of advertisement. They want to give the total quality experience to the individuals where the customers should not get distracted because of the external vibes. And if you go to the inside, look at the signboards, look at the sign images. As you keep going, there are the directions, there are the digital signages. There's a lot about the information about the product. And look at the kind of displaying of the product where you can touch, feel, and you can visualize how this can replicate if you're buying a product to your house. So this is what we call it as multi-sensory branding, where most of the company does this. They don't focus on one sense. Instead, they will have a permutation of the combination of the multi-sensory branding. Finally, Starbucks. Starbucks interior, it has got a unique architectural designing, and the light, intentionally the lights are very, very dim to give them the feel of having the good ambience and the aroma. Aroma musics will definitely put any sort of a stress monotonous of an individuals in a very, very cool space. And definitely the flavor of the coffee is one of the most instinct of every individuals. I have a video for you. So let's watch video and I'll get back to the conclusion part. Hope you all have got an insight into what is sensory branding. So ultimately, these are the reasons from the customer point of view, how they take up the decisions, how they judge on the product through the sense, consciously, subconsciously. Marketers are able to tap these customers and ensure that the brand is very well built in the minds of the consumer. The recall factor, the recognition factor, how they're able to differentiate through their logo, through their flavors, through their colors, through the shape of the product, and definitely stand out in the market. So that's all from my end. Thank you all. Over to Lakshmi.
Good. Welcome back. Hope you have been having a good time with our session. And now it's time for some fun. You have done enough of good learning or, absorbing some facts and all that. So I want you, all of you, to see the next slide and start just typing your, answers in the chat box. Do not raise your hands for this. We'll take up the questions in the audio format a little later. Can all of you see the questions here? Think of your favorite colors and the popular brands. Attach to them. Think of the familiar sounds and the brands you attach, associate with them, and think of fine aroma and the popular brands linked to them. And what was the feel of the product you last bought? So this is the basic kind. I want each of you to come up with at least a couple of answers out of the four, so that we will know that if you've got the groove of neuromarketing and sensory branding. Yellow idea, perfect. Blue Surf Excel, excellent. Blue Intel, very good. Blue Pepsi, awesome. Blue Hyundai, good. Red, Netflix, fantastic. Vodafone, red, good. Orange, MI, yes. Green, Sprite, good. Red, Airtel, good. Purple, Dairy Milk, yes. Fine. Now let's go on to the second one, sounds. All of you are super good with colors, I agree. And your branding, blue, Samsung, excellent. So we are done with this because we cannot go on for a long time. We're coming to inching towards the end of the session. So the second one, I want you all to associate sound. Okay, Airtel, iPhone tune, good. Airtel jingle, yes. Green Medimix, okay, fine. Vodafone, IPL ringtone. You cannot, you know, give me the same answers which you heard in your jingles. Dairy Milk song, yes. Docomo, good. Vodafone, good. Then IPL, again, IPL is already done and dusted. Please don't give us IPL or Little or Nirma, anything like that, because we've already seen it. Something new. Coca-Cola, yes. Nokia, fantastic answer. Awesome. Britannia, yes, definitely. Tata, but no, not necessary. Platinum, Mevera, yes, good. Amul, yes. Idea, Honey Bunny, good. Amul, yes, again. The sound of Amul, then, fine. Can you go to the third part of it? Aroma, the smell and the popular brand. Titan watches, awesome example. Sound and brands. CCD, yes. Aroma is for CCD, yeah, good, thank you. Then Dove soap, good. Nescafe coffee, good. Hard Press Bakery, yes. AM, FM channel, good. MTR, Brew, Little. So I think our session was not really bad. Only if you're able to associate and give answers. It's pretty participative. I like the participants, Domino's, KFC, Amul. It's really great. Can we go on to the next one? What is the feel, the touch, a Surf Excel liquid wash? Good. Mysore Sandal, excellent example. Nandini, feel of the product. Mahabharat, yes, sound good. Hammam, yes, Subway, Dove. Smartphone is a, yeah, feel. Fine, good. Next, feel for Amul. You feel the butter of Raymond's feel, okay, good. And signature blanket, good. Red and black dupe sticks, fine. Automobiles, absolutely. Yeah, this I didn't understand. K-U-R-N-O-L. What does that mean and which part of it are we trying to associate? Portico quill, good. Dove and Hammam, yes. Okay, beds, fine. And Bombay dyeing, yes. Fabric, fine. It's bedsheet, bedspreads and all that. Good. More examples for the last one. Raymond, Pierce, Bombay dyeing, fine. Some more for the last. I saw many answers for our colors. Second sound also was quite good enough. Search fashion, yes. Santoor, yes, good. Serums. How about your shampoos, your body lotions? Johnson's Baby Soap, good. QWERTY Keyback, correct. Excellent example. Then Lenskart, yes. Nivea, Himalaya. Oh, now comes all the answers. Come on. Absolutely great. Thank you so much for being participative. We open the session to a QA session. And we request you to raise your hands. And we might not be able to take all the questions. And some which are possible, definitely, yes, we would like to.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, good morning, Lakshmi ma'am.
Good morning.
Ma'am, this is Gurpreet, your ex-student 1618-.
Gurpreet, how are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
Doing great, thank you so much.
Your session was really very interesting. I want to ask that which is the best neuromarketing device which can be used as olfactory fragrance testing? Is it EEG or facial testing coding or GSR?
Now the answer is EEG. EEG records the currents of the brain. So for even your listening, even your taste, everything is totally controlled by the brain. Brain is the master. These are students. The brain. So encephalography is one of the best techniques today, which can give you a comprehensive account of, you know, how to get results from it.
Ma'am, I want to ask one more question. As you have taught four P's of marketing mix, So could you tell me how can neuromarketing research affect or influence pricing?
See, neuromarketing mainly targets promotion.
Okay.
Neuromarketing mainly targets promotion.
Promotion.
Of course, product and promotion are the main. And pricing and place comes after. Place, when you go to a store, when you see a website, the place is sold, or the website, the layout of the website, or when you walk into the store, all these are pretty important. Pricing will be a step after all this. The product is designed based on neuromarketing. Promotion is designed based on also done in such a way so that customers are attracted, and then comes the pricing aspect, that people are attracted. Once you get the customers, on various other factors also.
Okay, ma'am, it's the last question which I have a doubt in, that if we are having a research on neuromarketing, how can we minimize any risk perception which are in port of neuromarketing, which comes out?
Risk perception or disperception?
Risk perception.
See, the element of risk is there everywhere. Nothing is foolproof, especially in marketing. It's perception based, right?
Absolutely.
To an extent, yes, you can mitigate risk, but you cannot avoid it completely. If that is the method, then everybody invests billions of dollars and say, yes, wow, we've got this test to do. I will not spend any money in anything else. I will do this and get all my customers, and I will build up my market share. That will be the thing. The risk mitigation can be done. Risk aversion or risk cannot be avoided completely.
Sure. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Gurpreet. Next.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon. Sorry, I entered your session a bit late.
Yeah.
But this is one of the topics that me and my friend have done a paper research on, neuromarketing.
Yeah.
So I'm a student from Presidency, Bangalore, Presidency University.
Okay.
I would like to know, when we were doing the research, we heard that neuromarketing was still a part of research papers itself, and it was not being implemented in the market yet.
It's in the nascent stages, but many big corporations have started implementing it. It is in the nascent stages. Trial and run errors are being done.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, plus, and they're saying yes, and well, see, it's just like any other process. As you know, research never stops at one point.
True, ma'am.
Correct. Somebody else will come and find a research gap in that and say, first we can start researching on this aspect. So it is at a nascent stage. It is a new consumer decision science, but it is totally yet to be proven. Even if it's proven, somebody else will come up with some other logic and say, this works.
Very true, ma'am. I agree. Because when neuromarketing is a new concept, before we had something known as blue ocean strategy, which was being used. Nowadays, people want to use neuromarketing because they want to understand the consumer more better and better. Like, what do the person like? What are the needs of the person that the seller can use it in a different way to sell his products?
Yeah. Actually, blue ocean is a strategy for competition.
Yes, ma'am. That makes you, like example, Jio, that makes you undefendable with your same competitors in the same industry. Neuromarketing is quite different because here we are understanding the consumer's different type of what is the consumer buying behavior is. That's a main point here. And we try to make our research as practical as possible, but unfortunately we were still students then, and none of the professors helped us so much that we can understand it. But today, listening to your points, at least in the last moment, I understood that, oh, shit, I missed a very big session because I did this paper. Thanks to your session that I can understand that somewhere, hopefully, our research probably will come into practical any day very soon.
Definitely. Don't worry, we'll give you our email IDs. You can mail us your questions. We'll definitely reply back to you in case you put more questions there.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
I see one question here from Chandrakant to everyone. Will touch branding work in this pandemic, ma'am? Yeah, it's a very good question, but it's challenging. It's real challenging during pandemic, touching brand works. Hopefully all the online e-commerce industry are doing it. You order a product, it comes to your doorstep. Then again, you touch the product, you see the product. If you're okay, if you're not okay with it, again, all that exchange takes place. In pandemic time, touch concept, it's, I don't think so. It works better.
Next question. Neural marketing and neuromarketing is not almost identical, but they are concepts which are interlinked or intertwined, where there are similarities and there are differences. And neuromarketing is more to do with external testing and scientific facts to give you results based on the behavior of the consumer. We can take audio questions because it is, you know, the chat is scrolling up pretty fast. So if you have any questions, put up your hand. We can ask you questions here. We can take your questions here. One more question.
Sarini.
She's done.
There's a question, no? These are the answers.
Yeah. The chat box is overflowing with...
Can scroll down.
Yeah.
It's the fear and greed. Emotion is predominant.
How can marketers turn this into an opportunity given to them? See, you cannot give a generic answer for this, Medha, because the fear and greed may not be there in the same person. It cannot apply to the same product and at the same time for everybody. This answer cannot be pretty generic, because if you tell me what's the product, who's the consumer, who's the seller, what is the mode of selling, what is the mode of marketing, with all these permutations and combinations, yes, we will give. Just because it is pandemic, people don't die. Just because it's pandemic, people don't stop buying. Just because it's pandemic, things have slowed down a bit, but they've not come to an halt. They've not come to a standstill. Yet, the flow will go on. It'll take some time. It's like acceleration. Once you start accelerating it, it'll take, you stop and then start acceleration, it'll take time to gear up. So that is the reason, you know, nothing will come to a standstill. In fact, marketing has come a full cycle and a circle now, and we will see new dimensions in it going forward. Not in India, I'm talking about the whole world.
Vikram has raised now.
Okay, thank you so much, all of you. It was a wonderful audience to have you all as a wonderful audience, and it's our pleasure to have given such a session to a great set of audience, and we look forward to doing more with all of you, and hope you had the same kind of experience. Thank you so much, and to my colleague.
Thank you all. Thank you for your feedback. Hope it was very informative session for you all. I'd like to acknowledge our dean and the MDP team for giving this platform an opportunity to share our views and connect to this network. Thank you.
And we look forward, all of you, to fill the feedback forms and send us. Thank you so much. A great session too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Video off.